Well, good morning, and as always, it's great to see you all this morning. Welcome in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. If you don't know me, my name is John, and I'm a member here at Walton Evangelical Church. And so do let me invite you to stay after the service finishes for tea and for coffee. It's always a great chance, isn't it, to get to know each other better, especially if you're new or you're here for the first time. So please stay a little while after if you can. As always, a few church announcements before we start for the upcoming week, before we pray and before we sing. Firstly, for tomorrow, Monday, reminder to you ladies that the church women's Bible study is as usual here at the church, and that starts at 1 and goes on to about 2 p.m. Our midweek meeting this week is our ever-important church monthly prayer meeting, an opportunity to come and gather as a church to meet and take communion and to pray together. Let me remind you, encourage you to come to that on Wednesday at 7:30 p.m. again here at the church. Again, do try and get to that if you can. Also, there is another opportunity to come and pray together the day after at 2 p.m. as our Thursday afternoon prayer meeting faithfully continues in the lounge. That's the little room next door there, and that starts at 2 p.m. Also, Mick has mentioned this morning to me that there are 3 more Explorer leaflet packs to be delivered in the local area. If there are few who can help with that, you can pick the leaflets up in the back there, in the foyer. Also, if you can let Mick know, then he could add you to his group. And finally, on Sunday the 17th July, we're having a potluck fellowship meal after the morning service. If you'd be able to provide a cook main dish to serve about 10 people, then please sign up in the activity hall. Church will provide jacket potatoes and rice as usual. We'd love for everyone coming to bring a pudding to share. Again, that's on Sunday the 17th of July, so you've got a couple of weeks for that. There's 2 lists in the hall. There's 1 to attend and 1 to cook. Should we pray? Should we come before our Lord in prayer? And so, Father, we come to you this morning asking that you will take away all distractions, all worries, all concerns. We pray that we will focus on you, that your Holy Spirit will do his work amongst us, that you will meet with us right where we are this morning. Lord, we confess to you this morning our need of forgiveness and a thirst for your mercy. And we're thankful that you are faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness through Jesus Christ. Thank you that if we belong to you, for that hope, that reassurance because of the work of the cross. Do us good this morning. Bless our time together. And may we, as always, be very careful to give you all the honor and the praise and glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, let's stand and sing now as we worship our awesome God, as we declare he is holy, mighty, and worthy of praise. Let's stand and sing, "You are holy," and remain standing as after we'll sing, "Oh, how good it is." Come up and be ready to pray. Thanks.
Good morning, everyone. This one, if you remember, you men folk are going to follow Tim, and the ladies, you're going to follow me. So as the music starts, please stand.
I will listen.
Just get the music in front of us. And we're going to sing Oh How Good It Is, because isn't it when we can be all together as God's family? So let's sing this together.
He's everything to me. Colossians 3, verse 11. Christ is all and in all. And Isaiah chapter 12, verse 2. Behold, God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid. For the Lord Jehovah is my strength and my song. He also is become my salvation. He is everything to me. From sin he sets me free. Oh, himself, his peace and love, my portion through all eternity. He is everything to me, more than my dreams could be. Oh, praise his name forever. He is everything to me. In sin, I wandered, all weary, sad and lone, till Jesus, through his mercy, adopted me his own. Ere since I learned to trust him, his grace doth make me free, and now I feel his pardon, he's everything to me. In sin, no more I'll wander, he's pilot, friend, and guide. He brings me joy and singing, his spirit doth abide. A blessed, loving Saviour, the Lamb of Calvary, he purchased my redemption, he's everything to me. No longer will I stray from his tender, loving care, like him to be my purpose, my aim, my constant prayer. And when he bids me welcome throughout eternity, I'll praise his name forever. He's everything to me. Oh yes, he's everything to us. From sin he sets us free. Oh, himself, his peace and love, our portion through all eternity. Oh, he's everything to us, more than my dreams could be. Oh, praise his name forever. He's everything to me. Let's pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our God and our Heavenly Father, we thank you we can come into your holy presence in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to thank you for your love, your goodness, your mercy, your grace. Thank you, Father, for your great salvation and for your plan and your eternal purposes for us in Christ our Lord. Heavenly Father, thank you for the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world and now lives for us in the power of an endless life at your right hand. Father, thank you that you spared not your own Son, but delivered him up for us all. How shall you not with him freely give us all things? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Heavenly Father, thank you our Lord Jesus Christ was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. He came to his own, and his own received him not. But to as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. Father, thank you that our Lord Jesus Christ was with you in the beginning, and that the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. And of his fullness have we all received, and grace for grace. For the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. Lord, when we suffer in this fallen world, and especially as we suffer at the hands of an unbelieving world, help us, Lord, to remember that in Christ we are loved and accepted, in Christ who is our beloved. Help us, O our Lord, to remember the words of our Lord Jesus, that in the world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. Help us, Father, to take up our cross daily and follow our Lord as your obedient children in Christ. Thank you, our Lord Jesus has won the victory for us, and because he lives, we shall live also. Heavenly Father, help us, O Lord, to sing with heaven a new song. Thou art worthy to take the book and to open the seals thereof. For thou wast slain and hast redeemed us to God by thy blood. Out of every kindred, tongue, people, nation, hast made us unto our God kings and priests, a kingdom of priests, and we shall reign on the earth. Our God and our Father, help us in Christ to be sincere and true. Help us, Lord, to worship you with a single heart and a single eye to your honor and glory. Thank you, O our God. You are everything to us and our all in all. Lord, bless the gospel and the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ among us. Heavenly Father, thank you for your goodness and your faithfulness to us here at Walton, where you have placed your name. Lord, help our spiritual leaders to walk close to you, and we thank you for them. Have your hand upon them and be their all in all. Lord, have your hand upon us and help us not to have a divided heart in the things of God. Heavenly Father, thank you, for our Lord is the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David hath prevailed for us, and we thank you we can with heaven join and say, to God be the glory, great things he hath done. So loved he the world that he gave us his Son, who yielded his life in atonement for sin, who opened the life gate that all may go in. Thank you, our God and heavenly Father, for worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. Help us, O our God, to fix our gaze upon the Lamb. Thank you, Lord, for your love and grace. And thank you for the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness in Christ. For grace reigns through righteousness unto eternal life, by Jesus Christ our Lord. Thank you, O Lord. Amen.
Thank you, Steve. Well, our kids' song now speaks of the fact that without Jesus and his love and what he's done for us on the cross, without him, we are helpless. We need Jesus. It says no one is holy before God. No one is pure. No one is righteous. We need Jesus to save us. And so let's remind ourselves now what a mighty, mighty Savior we have as we'll stand and sing, No One Is Good.
Can I do the kids talk first?
Right, sorry. Can we have a kids talk?
Sorry.
Song.
Hello, everybody. Sorry, John. Good morning, everyone. Is the clicker here, Dan? Oh, there it is. Okay. That's my power this morning. Okay, we're going to be thinking about our powerful God. And can we have the, do I need to click it or does it come up? I know I'm not on the X, but I can put it up. There you go. We're going to be thinking about our powerful God, and we're looking again in creation, because creation is full of signposts pointing to him. And we're going to look at another signpost this morning to see if it can help us trust in God all the more. Everything God has made tells us how great he is. So our verse this morning is from Romans, and hopefully it all fits on the screen. Oh, I'm clicking, aren't I? Ta-da! Hopefully you can still see it, so let's read it together. There are things about God that people cannot see. His eternal power and all the things that make him God. But since the beginning of the world, those things have been easy to understand. They are made clear by what God has made. Romans chapter 1, verse 20. Let's read it one more time. There are things about God that people cannot see. His eternal power and all the things that make him God. But since the beginning of the world, those things have been easy to understand. They were made clear by what God has made. Romans chapter 1, verse 20. Oh, was it coming? Is it working yet? I don't know if it's turned on or not. There's lights on it. I'm going to just speak loudly, and when they've caught on. Right, I have primed some volunteers to show us their power this morning before we think about a different kind of power. Can I have them come to the... Oh, look, I'm having it back. I'm going with the broken one.
Yes. Okay. Powerful volunteers, you know who you are. Come forward. I'll have, let's call them the experienced on this side, please.
What are you getting to, you two?
Experienced, that's you as well. And I've got the youth on this side. Okay, so your challenge this morning should, we need the timer up, Dan. It's gone. If I click. Okay, there is going to be a 1 minute timer. Should you, your task, should you choose to accept it, is to see how many balloons you can blow up in a minute. You don't have to tie the knot. You can just, when it's full to capacity, this side you're counting for the youth, and this side you're counting for the experienced, okay? How many balloons can they blow up and just, you know, let them go? Ready, set, come and get them, go. Where are the sounds? Oh, it's coming. Make sure that they're fully, fully blown. Make sure you're counting them. How many are we at? Over here. If anybody feels faint, you have to stop, okay? No fainting. Are we... Oh, well, experience is... Whoa! Yeah, come and get another one. Woo! Woo! You didn't even let that one fly, Josiah. It just kind of went this way. Okay, 15 seconds left. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3. Okay, time's up. Okay, stop the music, Dan. Oh, do I click it? There we go. Right, how many did the experienced... 10 altogether. Okay, and youth? That's not bad. That's not bad. Some of them were harder to blow. Oh, well, there's a lesson learned, isn't it? Thank you very much, gentlemen. You can sit down. How much power do you have? Well, there's been quite a lot of air expelled right now, hasn't there? We'll collect up the balloons afterwards. I don't suggest that any of the kids go trying to blow them up after these guys have. But there we go. How much power do you have? Well, we're thinking about some stormy weather this morning. A storm, as pictured on here, is a serious disturbance in Earth's atmosphere. Apparently, that's the definition. But it can be
lots of different things. It could be a hailstorm, it could be a snowstorm, it could be a windstorm, or even a sand or dust storm. But do you know, the most common is the thunderstorm. There are, amazingly, 16 million thunderstorms a year on average in the world. And apparently, there can be up to 2,000 of them happening at any one time. That's a lot of power. Thunder, hence thunderstorm, is caused by lightning. And basically, the lightning heats up the air around it to 20,000 degrees Celsius, which is three times hotter than the surface of the sun, Google reliably tells me. And basically, because that heats up so quickly, it expands, and that's what creates the boom of the thunder. Who likes watching lightning? Yeah, it's a bit scary, isn't it? But it is mesmerizing. Well, the lightning capital of the world is this place in Venezuela. It's a lake called, let me get this right, Maracaibo. I'm not sure about the pronunciation. But apparently, they have storms up nearly 300 nights a year. And lightning can strike up to 28 strikes a minute. Sorry, that's the average, but up to 3,600 strikes per hour. Now, that would be an impressive storm to see. But do you know what? You can see it from 250 miles away. Now, I don't know about you, but that's pretty powerful. But even more so is this. This is a tropical cyclone. And they have the power of hundreds of thunderstorms. Basically, depending on where you are in the world, there's only less than 100 of these a year, thank goodness. But depending on where you are in the world, they're called different things. So in the Atlantic, it's a hurricane. In the South Pacific, it's a cyclone. And if you're in the West Pacific, then it's a, what is it? I'm losing my place on here, I'm sorry. It's the typhoon, that's it. I thought I would be able to see it, but no, I can't read it from there. There we go. No matter what you call these storms, they are super powerful. And they have wind speeds of even more than 150 miles per hour. And the storm can spread as big as 1,200 miles across. Now, I don't know about you, but that's a lot of power. And it's hard to even imagine that much power, isn't it? But do you know what? These storms have nothing in comparison to our powerful God. All he had to do was speak, and light came into being. Stars were formed, the oceans met where he put them, and mountains went into place. And Jesus knows a thing or two about storms too, doesn't he? He walked on waves, and they didn't slow him down. And one time, he even slept through a storm. That was until his disciples woke him up. And then all he had to do was say, "Quiet, be still." Can you imagine if you could just say that to kids and they actually would? That would be great, wouldn't it? But all he had to do just to the wind and the waves, quiet and be still, and they did. Now, that is power. But do you know what? When Jesus went to the cross in our place as our substitute, he showed that he had power over sin and death. He said the words, "It is finished." And he gave up his life to 3 days later rise again, taking it back to show his power. Well, I don't know about you, but God is more powerful than all of everything powerful in this whole wide world put together, isn't he? And nothing in this world happens or is out of his control. Creation shouts that there is a God, and this God has revealed himself in his word, the Bible. Sorry, forgot that slide. So, remember our verse, there it is, that talks about God's power being seen in what he has made. And remember our fourth sign. And if you see lightning or hear thunder, Remember the God who is in control of them and let yourself wonder about him and what his power can do in your life. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you that you sent Jesus to be our mighty, mighty Savior, that you have more power than anything in this whole wide world. You made it and you hold it and us in your hands. And we thank you that we can trust you, that even though we are so sinful, that you will forgive us when we ask and that you will be our mighty, mighty Savior. In whose name we pray. Amen. And we're going to sing that now. I'll turn this back off. Let me just put this back.
That's my power. It's heavy. Okay.
So, no one is good, but we have a good, good God. Okay. We're on capo 3. Are we all in the right key?
I think so.
Sound about right?
No one is good. No one is holy before God.
Reading this morning is from Acts chapter 17, starting at verse 15. Those who escorted Paul brought him to Athens and then left with the instructions for Silas and Timothy to join him as soon as possible. While Paul was waiting for them in Athens, he was greatly distressed to see that the city was full of idols. So he reasoned in the synagogue with both Jews and God-fearing Greeks, as well as in the marketplace, day by day, with those who happened to be there. A group of Epicurean and Stoic philosophers began to debate with him. Some of them asked, "What is this babbler trying to say?" Others remarked, "He seems to be advocating foreign gods." They said this because Paul was preaching the good news about Jesus and the resurrection. Then they took him and brought him to a meeting of the Areopagus, where they said to him, "May we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting? You are bringing some strange ideas to our ears, and we would like to know what they mean." All the Athenians and the foreigners who lived there spent their time doing nothing but talking about and listening to the latest ideas. Paul then stood up in the meeting of the Areopagus and said, "People of Athens, I see that in every way you are religious. For as I walked around and I looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, 'To an unknown God.' So you are ignorant of the very thing that you worship. And this is what I am going to proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth and does not live in temples built by human hands. And he is not served by human hands as if he needed anything. Rather, he himself gives everyone life and breath and everything else. From one man, he made all the nations that they should inhabit the whole earth. And he marked out their appointed times in history and the boundaries of their lands. God did this so that they would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far from any one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. As some of your own poets have said, we are his offspring. Therefore, since we are God's offspring, we should not think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image made by human design and skill. In the past, God overlooked such ignorance, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent. For he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof of this to everyone by raising him from the dead." When they heard about the resurrection of the dead, some of them sneered, but others said, "We want to hear you again on this subject." At that, Paul left the council. Some of the people became followers of Paul and believed. Among them was Dionysius, a member of the Areopagus, also a woman named Damaris, and a number of others.
Thank you, Sarah. Well, before Andy comes up and speaks from that passage, let's stand again and sing, during which the kids will go out to their Sunday classes and the little ones will go out to creche. So let's stand and sing now, "My Jesus, My Saviour."
Mountains by Well, good morning, everyone. Please do have your Bibles open at Acts chapter 17. We're looking at this very exciting city that Paul's arrived in, the city of Athens. No one's heard of Berea. I mean, where's Berea? But Athens. Okay, we've got to pay attention here. This is big, isn't it? So please do have your Bibles open. Let's come to the Lord in prayer before we get going. Father, we do ask that you would help us this morning as we look into your word. Lord, please speak to each one of us. Challenge us. Move us, we pray, by your Spirit. We might become more like the Lord Jesus, that we might have the same burdens and passions as his followers have had before us. So Lord, help us, we pray. Amen. Well, now, I don't know who judges these things, but did you know that yet again, apparently, this year, London was crowned best city in the world? Okay, according to the website bestcities.org, so it must be right, they say this: as the capital of capitals, still waist-deep in an opaque pandemic slurry, negotiates the uncharted perilous terrain of post-Brexit world, London continues to reign the planet's best city for the sixth year running. Can you believe that? Aren't you proud to be British? And it gets better, actually, because another survey conducted by Which found that the happiest place to live in the East Midlands, okay, the different categories, is Chesterfield. Happiest place in the East Midlands. Isn't that great? So in short, my fellow Chesterfieldians or Spirites, it is only downhill from here if you move away. Bear that in mind. If you're ever thinking of moving, you're just moving away from happiness, okay? Don't do it. Now, Athens was an incredible place to live. It still is an amazing place to visit. It was already an ancient city, even in the days of the Apostle Paul when he visits there. It's ancient, even in those categories. And it was full of art and full of breathtaking architecture. It was also a place that was absolutely full of ideas. Anybody who was doing any thinking was, you know, their thoughts were making it to Athens. It was the birthplace of democracy. It was the home of playwrights and historians and physicians and philosophers. And as for religion, with the Acropolis, there it is on the screen there, the Acropolis towering out over the city, over the valleys there. It had its temples and its shrines. It had a religious infrastructure that could rival any city in the known world. Now, you may remember, if you've been coming to our series, going through Acts, Paul's been escorted south. He keeps on moving south, down from Macedonia, and he's been delivered to Athens. And he's waiting in Athens, so we're told here, for the arrival of his colleagues, of Timothy and Silas. They're still finishing up in Berea, that little town further north. Now, this sounds like an exciting place to spend a few days, doesn't it? There's Paul, he's on his own, he's got a bit of a break, you know, the boys haven't quite arrived yet. You'd think he'd want to just, you know, get a kebab? I don't know what they have in Athens, you know, get some of the local food, rest, perhaps sun himself on a beach for a bit. But that's not quite what he does it? Look at verse 16. While Paul was waiting for them in Athens, he was greatly distressed to see that the city was full of idols. John Calvin writes this. He says, "The whole world was then full of idols. The pure worship of God could be found nowhere. And there was everywhere innumerable monsters of superstition. But Satan had made the city of Athens more mad than any other city, so that the people thereof were carried headlong with greater madness unto their wickedness and perverse rites." And this example is worth noting, that the city, which was the mansion house of wisdom, the fountain of all arts, the mother of humanity, did exceed all others in blindness and madness. That's what we see really here in the passage we've got in front of us. Now that verse, that first verse there tells us that when Paul saw the city and walked around the city, he became greatly distressed. I want to really sort of think about that for a bit this morning. the great distress of Paul. The actual word in that verse is this word paroxeno. It's a brilliant little word, paroxeno. It means more than just a bit distressed. It's got kind of two ideas behind the word. You've got the idea of anger bubbling up, and you've got the idea of grief. Imagine putting grief and anger together. That's how Paul's feeling as he walks around this tremendous city. One writer describes what Paul meets as he enters the city and looks around the city as being, he's amongst a forest of idols. So as Paul tours the city, he sees the temples. He sees the idols and the shrines. And it makes this pity, this anger, well up in his stomach. He's grieved. Here is a city that has sold itself wholesale to idolatrous things and idolatrous ideas. And they're blind and enslaved in satanic darkness. Here's a city where thousands are sliding into a godless eternity. That's how Paul sees it. They're deceived. All manner of wicked lies are coming in through their ears. And he's moved deep down by what he sees. He's angry at the demonic influence that this idolatry has over people. Deeply saddened. Blindness. Lostness all around him. Without hope and without God in the world. That's how he describes another Turkish city. Now this morning I want you just to think then, as we look at this, what is it that moves you like that? Do you get moved like that when you look around at the world around you? As a Christian, are you moved? Do you sometimes look at things that people are living for, that people are pinning their hopes on, and do you despair when you see where it is that they've put those hopes? No regard for God, no thought really of eternity, just trying to ignore it. Filling their lives with substitutes like money and sex and pastimes and possessions. Do you sometimes listen to the media around you? You know, watch the box sets, watch the TV, listen to the radio, and get angry when God is warped and misrepresented, maligned, dismissed? When God becomes replaced by so-called reason. We've got reason now, so we can throw out all of that God stuff. We mustn't become desensitized to this as we see it in our world, must we? Because often we see and hear this stuff so much that it becomes a background noise, and we don't really care too much, I think, sometimes about it. But it ought to tear at our hearts. We too should be paroxenode, or whatever the word is, greatly distressed. Now, Paul's a man of action, so he's got to do something. Yeah, he's a bold person. He's a great example to look at. We've already seen how we're supposed to follow his example. But look at what he does, verse 17. So he reasoned in the synagogue with the Jews and with God-fearing Greeks, as well as in the marketplace, day by day with those who happened to be there. So every day, Paul's getting himself over to the synagogue because he knows how that works. And he's reasoning in the synagogue with people as he normally does. But then, you know, as soon as that's over, he's down to the marketplace. He's talking to anyone who will listen. Look at verse 18. A group of Epicurean and Stoic philosophers began to dispute with him. I don't know about you. If they started to dispute with me, I'd just say, I'm going home. But not Paul. And some of them asked, yeah, what is this babbler trying to say? Others remarked, he seems to be advocating foreign gods. They said this because Paul was preaching the good news about Jesus and the resurrection. That is Paul's response to all of this that he sees. But now, strap your seatbelts on, because whenever we do anything to do with Greek philosophy, I'm like, whoa, okay, let's be careful here. But I want to just go and just try and get to grips a little bit with what's going on in Athens. So I'm going to fill you in a little bit on these guys, these Epicureans and Stoics. These are the kind of worldviews that underpinned the Athenian culture. And as we go through this and just try and get to grips with it a little bit, I want you to be asking yourself, do we still see these ways of thinking in our world today? How much have we actually changed? So first of all, Epicureanism. So the Epicureans believed that pleasure is the highest good to be aimed at in life. It's all about pleasure. A pleasure for them is basically a state of trouble-free tranquility. So it's Hakuna Matata, isn't it? Yeah? And therefore, if you want this pleasure, this contentment, you have to avoid excesses because there's a price to be paid later. So just because I'm a pleasure seeker, I'm not going to go so far that I'm going to get a hangover the next day. Yeah? I want to avoid that. This tranquil happiness comes at a cost, though, of if I'm going to get this, I've got to withdraw myself from too much involvement in the world. I don't want to be involved in the rough and tumble of life. I'll move away from that to seek my pleasure elsewhere. So you can already start to see it's not really the kind of philosophy of the working man, is it? Who can just take himself off somewhere and not worry about, you know. This is someone who's got a bit in the bank account, haven't it? The Epicureans. According to their philosophy, we are not answerable to a creator who cares how we behave. So there might be gods, but they're just creatures like you and I. And by the way, the gods themselves are also presumed to be Epicurean, right? So they don't really care what's going on with man. They're just seeking their own contentment and pleasure elsewhere. The gods live a trouble-free life of enjoyment, and we're supposed to follow their example. Amazingly, and this is quite cool really, they had a sophisticated view of matter, they tell us. So they believed that matter was made of atoms. That's pretty cool, isn't it? They can't see them, but they believed it. The gods, you see, dwell in the spaces between the atoms. Can you picture this? It's mind-blowing stuff, isn't it? The atoms originally, you see, all just fell and showered, apparently, and piled up in piles in the universe. The flow that gets into piles might become something. So that's where everything has its origin, just falling matter and chance. Everything's a product just of matter, really, when it comes down to it. It's a combination of atoms, even including the human soul, they would say. So there's no creator. And therefore, you know, you don't have to worry about judgment or consequences in the next life. No punishment, no hell. Because of this also, necessarily, there's no justice. Not really, no ultimate justice for millions. No satisfactory answer to evil. And that's another reason to just detach from life. Do you see any of these things in our world today? Is Epicureanism still alive? And then you've got the Stoics, okay? So whenever you've got a movement like this, you've got a reaction to it, haven't you? Because people just like to disagree with each other as much as anything else. So the Epicureans, they opposed the Stoics, they opposed the Epicureans, and especially the whole setting up of pleasure or whatever kind, that being the chief end of life. No, they're not into that. They're going to be Stoic. We kind of know the word, don't we? The chief aim, according to their philosophy, was to live in perfect agreement with nature. Is this ringing any bells? To be virtuous. The Stoics would have produced T-shirts that would have said things like this: there's a spark of the divine in us all. We want to be a citizen of the world. I'm a citizen of the world, yeah? I'm part of the brotherhood of all mankind. That's the Stoic. And virtue for them is the only good in life, to be lived in harmony with reason. Lack of virtue is the only evil. So the virtuous life, and this is interesting, the virtuous life is, I've got to be free of all passions. I don't want to be a passionate person. I'm going to keep that under control. Because passions are intrinsically disturbing and they're harmful to the soul. Passions, you see, when you care too much about something, it leads to expectations. And expectations lead to inevitable disappointments. And I don't want to deal with that. So better to have an even keel. Don't expect too much. Don't care for too much. Just deal with life. When bad stuff's happening, it's good to resist it. But when it happens, you just got to steel yourself, get your emotions under control and accept it. Keep calm and carry on, right? As a philosophy, Stoicism produced people that were very courageous and had fine character. They were good moral people. rather than the Epicurean view of creation being sort of this chance arrangement of atoms, the Stoics believed in fate and in providence. They believed that at the heart of the universe there was reason, there was some sort of vital force that, you know, is connecting everything and involved in it and working on behalf of the whole. And so that made them pantheists. So there, have you ever seen the film Avatar? It's that sort of idea. Yeah, all plugged into this blue stuff. Well, maybe not blue, but the stuff that's just pervading everything. Now, Athens, you've got all of this going on, these two sort of schools of philosophy. And then on top of that, with this whole melting pot of philosophy, you've got the average bloke who doesn't want to do all that much thinking. I probably would have been in this group, I've got to say. And so running in parallel with this highfalutin philosophy sort of stuff, you've got the pagan idol worship going on, just the standard stuff, the religion of the state, basically. And fundamental to that is the principle of keeping the gods happy. You do that with the way you live and the offerings that you make and, you know, money you give and all of that sort of stuff. Keep them happy. Keep the gods sweet, because then they will bless you. I think perhaps today we might call that superstition, right? So you've got all of that going on. And as Luke tells us in verse 21, so picture this culture. All the Athenians and foreigners who lived there spent their time doing nothing but talking about and listening to the latest ideas. Now, I assume that's a bit of an exaggeration, but you can imagine this culture. I mean, they're just anything that's posted up on YouTube or Snapchat or any of these things. The latest idea, this meme, that, this, they're just that obsessed with it. The phone is always out and they're flicking through it. They just want to, you know, the latest idea. And so in summary, at heart, this is a world full of people desperately trying to navigate through life, aren't they? And they're working everything out around them, really, essentially, to their advantage. That's what they're doing with all of these different approaches. They're desperately seeking fulfillment, advantage, contentment. Has anything changed? The forms might have changed. The heart is still the same today. And when these people initially heard what Paul had to say, they got this. There was this mixed response. Look at it again in verse 18. It's the sort of, what's this babbler trying to say? And others are remarking, well, he seems to be advocating foreign gods or something. The word babbler there, it literally means this seed picker. You're supposed to get the idea of this bird that flutters around, pecking a seed up here, and then flutters around and pecks another seed up here. And it all just sounds a bit weird and eclectic to those who are hearing him. This Paul bloke, he comes here from the east with his foreign gods and he's cobbling together some sort of patchwork religion. And some of it sounds familiar and other bits of it are just a bit weird. There's a bit of Judaism in there. I recognize that. There's a bit of philosophy. There's ideas here, there and everywhere. My head's spinning. And so because what Paul is saying is interesting, well, they invite him to address the Areopagus. Now, this is the hub of where everything's going on in the thinking in Athens. It's a hill just across from the Parthenon, overlooking the marketplace, an imposing lump of marble with steps carved up the side of it. And the thinkers and the, as Luke calls them, the lovers of novelty, well, that's where they sit and have their lunch and their cup of tea and chat together. So verse 19 then. May we know what this new teaching is that you're presenting, they ask. You're bringing some strange ideas to our ears. We want to know what they mean. And what follows in our text is just the highlights, really, of what Paul says to them. But his approach and the central points of Paul's presentation, I think, are really helpful for us today. Because we live in this crazy melting pot kind of world. All these weird thoughts about life and eternity. I love the way that Paul starts here. Let's have a look at what he says to them. This is the meat, really, of what we've got in the passage. And Paul's got his way in with this eclectic group of people. He's got it all sorted. Look at the genius of what Paul does. First of all, a little compliment. He's going to hook them, okay? Look at the hook. Men of Athens, he cries. I see in every way you're very religious. Yeah? What a religious group. And now some light humour, perhaps. Verse 23. As I walked around and looked at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, to an unknown God. Man, you guys, you are incredibly religious. Brilliant. And then his way in. Now, you lot, with all your religion and your unknown religion, what you worship is something unknown? That's what I'm going to proclaim to you. That's what I'm all about. It's an engaging introduction, isn't it? Especially to this kind of crowd who just want to know stuff. I should think he's got everyone's undivided attention. So how's he going to get them to the truth of the gospel? Let's look at it briefly. He starts, and I've got 5 points here. You could probably pick more out than that. But he starts, at the very least, by laying some foundations. This is what Paul thinks is really important. It's really dealing with the question of, what do I mean when I say God? That's a pretty good place to start, isn't it, with a conversation with people, isn't it? What do I mean when I say God? First point, then, is there is a creator God. There's an uncreated creator who is God. Verse 24, the God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth, and he doesn't live in temples made by hands. Okay? So creation's not a chance occurrence. It's not just a piling up of atoms just scattering through the universe. And there's not an impersonal interconnecting force of reason just holding everything together. No. The difference between the God of the Bible and all other gods is the difference of creator and creation. That's a brilliant way of just getting people to understand what we mean when we say God, isn't it? Every other God you want to throw that, you know, people want to say, you know, you Christians, you know, you're just out to lunch. I mean, really what you're advocating is basically you're the kind of people that if you'd lived a few years earlier, you'd believe in Thor, wouldn't you? And you've got all of this sort of stuff going on, Santa Claus and Thor. No, 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 no. Those are created. The God we believe in, he's uncreated. That's the God of the Bible. Now we're clear. Now we know which God we're talking about. There's a personal God. A God who rules his creation and rules over everything that exists. And if that is so, says Paul, look at the conclusions. It's absurd to think that the God who supervises and runs the universe might be contained in a shrine or a temple. Ridiculous belief. He's limited, localized, or confined to a building. Second point then. So we know which God it is we're talking about. Secondly, what's more, this God is actually the sustainer of all life. That's quite important. Look at verse 25. He's not served by human hands as if he needed anything, because he himself gives all men life and breath and everything else. That's what you need to know about this God. We depend on him. He doesn't depend on us. He continues to keep all life going. That's the God I'm proclaiming to you. Every heartbeat, every breath you breathe depends on him. This is not a God who created a universe like clockwork and wound it up and then went off to do something else. No, he doesn't dwell between the atoms. No, without him, the atoms of the universe would just fall apart. He's holding it all together. It's absurd then to think that the sustainer, the one who holds it all together, needs the help of those that he's sustaining to sustain him. You can't domesticate the true God. You can't keep him as some kind of a pet needing your provision. You can't manipulate him. The whole idea is mad, this whole pagan idea. And yet, you know we look at that and that sounds quite clear to us, doesn't it? Yeah, as Christians, we sort of think, yeah, of course, that's the Christian God. But how many of us, maybe even here in this room, treat God a bit like that? Like he is some sort of creation. Like if we do the right things for him, yeah? If I just got my quiet time sorted every day, you know, if I just did that, well, he'd be better disposed towards me, wouldn't he? Can I just say that's the cornerstone of pagan religion? I'm not saying don't have your quiet times. I'm just saying don't believe in a God like that. Go to him because you love him. Don't go to him because you think by stroking him, the genie will come out of the lamp. No, that's pagan. Third thing, really important, is that he rules, and this is an important point for the Athenians, he rules all the nations. Verse 26, look. From one man he made every nation, that they would inhabit the whole earth, and he determined the times set for them, the exact places where they would live. And God did this so that men would seek him and perhaps reach out to him and find him, though he's not far from each one of us. For in him we live, move, have our being. In other words, this answers really what they were saying down in the marketplace, doesn't it? Paul's not advocating foreign gods. This is not foreign gods. This is not, you're way too small here. You know, this idea that they had in the ancient world of territorial gods, you know, when Paul in the next chapter is going to go to Ephesus, you've got these shrine makers who, you know, they're crying out about Artemis, the god of the Ephesians, because they kind of owned him. He's in their territory. No. This is the God of all the nations. This is the one God before whom all people are accountable. It's not a case of you're born in Britain, that's why you're a Christian. But, you know, if you had been born in the Middle East, well, you'd be a Muslim and Allah would be your God. No. You can't take your pick like that. He made all men from one man, Adam. He doesn't belong to any culture or people. They belong to him. That's the God we're preaching. And according to verse 27, it is actually the duty, look, of all people to seek him. You should all be seeking him. The word seek here actually carries the idea of just fumbling around and looking for something. That's the idea. Like a blind man searching in the dark, wanting to verify by contact, by getting their hand on this thing. And unfortunately, though we should all be doing that, we don't. Because of our sinfulness, we don't seek God. In fact, we prefer to suppress the truth. We were just looking at it, weren't we? From Romans chapter 1 in the children's talk. We prefer to suppress the truth about God, though it might well be obvious. We just grope for it, or don't even try to grope for it. We would rather dictate God than discover God. That's the human heart, isn't it? You think about it. We'd rather say what God is like than actually go and find God. And hence, mankind must always grope around in the dark regards God unless their eyes are opened. And yet, to be clear, despite our blindness, says Paul, he isn't distant or unknowable or uninterested. That's the point Paul's making here. We distance ourselves from him. We try to shove him away, pretend he doesn't exist. Yet verse 27 says, he's not far from each one of us. And in him we live and move and have our being. You know, when we look at creation, we saw it, didn't we? Something within us stirs and we kind of know this is right. And we're going to react to that. We've got to force it out of the way. We want to suppress it. It's not that it's not clear. He's knowable. Because he's revealed himself to us. So Paul continues, look, as some of your own poets have said, we are his offspring, verse 28. And therefore, since we are God's offspring, we shouldn't think of the divine being as something made of gold or silver or stone, an image made by man's design or skill. This unknown God, the creator of all, is in fact, fourthly then, the father of all human beings. What an interesting point for Paul to bring home. Do you ever tell people about that? What does he mean? But Paul actually quotes two of their own prophets in this, because there are glimmers and flashes of truth that mankind can find. And so he can quote these people. And they've figured something out. The thinkers of the day, the poets of the day, they've hit on something, says Paul. They're right here. We are, all of us, God's creatures, receiving our life from him. And so in a sense, we've originated from him. It's something we know on some level. And so it's absurd to think that God is like an image of gold or silver or stone which came from the imagination of man. No. Actually, it's the other way round. We are made in the image of God. God isn't made in our image or in an image we like to conjure up. No, we are made in the image of God. That's the madness you see of idolatry. It actually turns it upside down. Mankind becomes the originator, the sustainer, the creator of God. That's not the God that we're preaching. And so, having dismantled a collection of worldviews and philosophies, Paul now moves in with his final blow. And this is where we have to get with the gospel, isn't it? Look at what he says in verse 30. I mean, this is where everything starts to turn sour. They're probably really intrigued by what Paul's got to say up until this point. And then he says in verse 30, in the past, God overlooked such ignorance. But now he commands people everywhere to repent. For he set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he's appointed. And he's given proof of all of this to all men by raising him from the dead. I mean, that's just a step too far, isn't it, for the people? But his fifth point is this, and he makes no bones about it. This God I'm preaching to you is the judge before whom all will one day stand. The Athenians had admitted their ignorance about the God that they didn't know. Do you see that? He's the unknown God to them. They don't know everything, despite all their intelligence. And Paul has agreed. He's shown them just how little they know the real God. But he concludes the matter by declaring that now you've heard, there's no excuse for such ignorance. And if you willingly remain in the dark, in blindness, you're going to do so by your own choice from this point forwards. That's what he's saying. You are now culpable because I've revealed this God to you. I've told you about him. Up until now, God's overlooked that kind of ignorance. I mean, it's quite amazing language to be using in front of the Areopagus in all of their great wisdom and knowledge to say, no, I've shown you your ignorance, your own self-confessed ignorance, and I've shown you how ignorant it is. By overlooked here, Paul doesn't mean that God didn't notice or that God has dismissed this ignorance, but rather that God's judgment against that ignorance has been held up and held back until this point because God is patient. But now it's different. Now you must turn. Now you must repent because judgment is coming and it's urgent that you do so. When Paul wandered into this city, he was deeply distressed because here were a people heading totally unprepared towards a great and terrible day of judgment. That's where he's got to in his presentation. I mean, notice just some of the details about that judgment. It's worth just seeing it. It's a universal judgment. He will judge the world, because he's the God of the world. The whole world, every culture, land, people, the great, the good, the rich, the poor. No one will escape from the Creator, because you can't run or hide from the God that made, sustains, knows everything. And it will be a just judgment, says Paul. Everyone will get total, just, final judgment. The wrongs done against you, yes, they'll be settled, and likewise all of the wrongs that you have done. Justice will be done. And the uncreated Creator, the one who witnesses everything and knows every deep, dark secret of your life, he will finally bring all of it to light and do justly. And it will be definite, says Paul. He's almost saying here, isn't he, the clock's ticking, people. He has set a day. The day is set. A day of final judgment, universal judgment. And the coming of that day, Paul finally says, and this is really what turns them off, isn't it? The coming of this day is definite because the judge is the one who's been raised from the dead. I mean, really, he's kind of saying here, look, if you don't like this idea of judgment, okay, if you want to try and just sort of get rid of this idea of judgment, all you've got to do is prove the resurrection didn't happen. Because if it did, there's a judgment coming. Now listen, I don't think this sermon here is recorded to give us an outline for preaching to Athenians or philosophy students, okay? I don't think that's what this is here for. It's very helpful, isn't it? But in fact, you know, according to one source, this would have probably have taken about 3 to 4 hours for Paul to address the Areopagus. That's how long they would meet for to listen to somebody. What we've got here in Acts 17 is some bullet point summaries to help us think things through, isn't it? I'm sure Paul went into detail in every point that he spoke about. I'm sure he talked about the cross and explained Jesus' death as our substitute to pay for our sins. What we've got here is, I think, Paul's response, according to Luke, to the big issues on the ground in Athens. He explores the city. He speaks with the people. He goes to the marketplace. He talks to the common man. He disputes with the philosophers and the educated. He visits the places of worship. He reads their literature. It's all very instructive to us, isn't it? He's let their culture, their world, get under his skin to the point that it angers him and pains him. And so what we have here in these little sermon notes here is Paul debunking Athenian religion and philosophy. His best attempt at dismantling a blind and foolish philosophy of the world around him. So Epicureans, look at it. We are more than just a chance arrangement of atoms. We owe our being to a personal creator. A creator who's not like the idols in your temples or the gods in your pantheon. You need a new category, a personal, involved creator. Not himself part of creation, but one who designed and sustains you and who brings meaning to all parts of your life, even the suffering in your life, and one who will judge the world justly. So Epicureans, be warned, repentance is necessary. You need to repent before, while there's still time. And Stoics, the creation's not driven by some impersonal force, by fate or providence. There's a knowable creator. You're not part of the divine. But God is very close to you. In him you live and move and have your being. You're groping in the dark, but the God who made you is the Father, who longs for you to repent and be spared from the judgment coming. And you, religious idolater, think, how can the God who sustains your very existence be contained or housed or provided for by you? How can an object crafted out of gold or silver, made from your imagination, ever possibly portray the God who formed you? Leave those childish idols behind. The God I proclaim made all men, and he's the God of all the peoples of the world. Do you see, Paul is answering their objections, removing the blindness of the world that he wants to preach to. So really this morning, I just want to ask the question, what about you and me? I mean, how do we do this? Are we deeply disturbed by the world around us? Do you walk around your town or your neighborhood, absorbing the sights and the sounds each day, and just nothing more, go to bed and just try to forget about it? Does the news and media of our world just wash over you? You know, you watch that new box set and you sort of have this niggling feeling behind you. Yeah, this is just not quite right, is it? I wonder if there's an agenda they're pushing here. Or does it really trouble you? Do you talk about it? Do you know the world that you're trying to reach and that you've been sent to make disciples of? Their way of thinking, their philosophies of life. What about your friends, your colleagues, your neighbors? Have you tried to figure out what they think life is all about? Have you watched what they watch and listened to what they listen to? And I don't just mean for entertainment, but have you thought about what they're imbibing every day and where it leads? How can you answer them? We really need to put some thought into that, don't we? And we've said this before, but Christians they're very much like boats. You shouldn't be sat in the dry dock. That's not what a boat is for. A Christian, like a boat, needs to be out in the water. A Christian needs to be out in the world. We need the world all around us. We need to hear what it's saying. We need to see what it's doing, and we need to process these things so that we can give an answer. You don't want to let the water into the boat, obviously. You keep the water out there. And some of us, I'm guessing, might need to operate the bilge pump just a little bit and get some of that water out. But you must engage with the water. We're not to be a church that just sits separated from the world around us. We've got such good news. No one is going to listen if it just sounds like so much babble and we never really get to grips with the world around us. So does this world trouble you? Are you distressed by the world around you, by their plight. I know some of you are. This world is groping in darkness, so what will we do? By and large, Chesterfield's just heading for a godless eternity, isn't it? They need to know about Jesus. They need the light of the world to shine in the darkness. And that's the call of the book of Acts, isn't it? To be those who do that, who follow in the footsteps of those first messengers. So what will you do this week? What will you do to engage with your culture? Not just sort of to enjoy it, but to engage with it and think about the culture so that we might reach them for Christ. Let's pray. Father, we ask that you would, by your Spirit, that you would move us, that we would be moved and angered by the things that we see in the world around us, and that that would drive us into action, not just to shake our heads and tut. Father, we pray for our world, for the overwhelming muddle of worldviews and philosophies that just go nowhere. We pray, Lord, that you would help us to engage with that. Help us to be able to question it with people and to lead them to the truth. Father, as we hold out words of life to this lost world, we pray, Lord, that you would remove the blindness, just like you did for some there that day in Athens. Father, open the hearts of men and women and children as we speak with them. Father, we ask all of this in your name and for your glory. Amen.
Thanks, Andy. And so as we feel the weight and think about what we've just listened to from Acts 17, with that in mind, let's sing our final song now. Let's sing, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing.
Stand. Come thou fount of every blessing, tune your heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Here I raise to post his presence.
Let's just finish with these words from Jude. To him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God our Saviour be glory, majesty, power and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen.